thought that you're probably all interested in doing the kind of invention I've heard about for many years, and that was to invent a better mousetrap, right? Isn't that what you're all interested in? Is that your slogan, we invent a better mousetrap?
Sure.
Well, if you're wondering whether the world needs a better mousetrap, they do. And I know if you have a $500 mousetrap today, I know somebody that wants to buy that. I know somebody who makes a $500 mousetrap. And so the obvious question is, who needs a $500 mousetrap? And the answer is anyone with a 100-pound mouse. This is not a joke. This is serious. Who has a 100-pound mouse and would need a $500 mousetrap? Right here we are. They got 200-pound mice, one big fat duck, and a dog. And so there's a place that needs a better mousetrap. Imagine you have hundreds of acres of property. You're going to invite 50,000 kids to come in every day and spill their cookies and their drinks and their ice cream and their hot dogs all over the place, and you want to keep it spick and span, and now you've got mice all over the place trying to clean up after the kids. Well, one solution is to put 1,000 old mouse traps out there and have 10 people who do nothing every day, they don't want dead mice laying around, who go out and clean up the dead mice in the 12 that they caught that day. Or you could be like this company, Exocyte, Minneapolis-based company, built a $500 mousetrap that has Wi-Fi connections, so anytime a mouse is caught in a mousetrap, they get a notification and they run to that one mousetrap, pick up that one mouse. So there is room for a better mousetrap. I'm going to jump subjects here pretty fast. We're going to be talking about cryptocurrencies, and I think the battery seems like it's going, but cryptocurrencies, and we've heard about Bitcoin. We'll talk a little bit about Bitcoin, but if you really want to make a killing, I got this from last week, and it shows a company called Ethereum. Anybody heard of Ethereum? That's one competitor of Bitcoin, and if you look on that particular day, on the stock market, I like to track some of these technical stocks, everybody was in the tank except one company right there, Ethereum, ETH. So you should have started buying into that company. We'll get back to that company's progress a little bit later. And while we're on this, I don't know if you like to get onto Wi-Fi or anything else, but if you do, there is a new site here. It's called the Hopkins CC Free Site. You can try that to see if it works. I will warn you of one thing. If you do it, everything you do there will be going through my iPhone because I named my iPhone Hopkins CC Free Site. And so it's a hotspot, free to use. So feel free to put your credit card numbers and everything else in there. Couple of items here. There's a newsletter sign-up sheet. I write a monthly, fairly short newsletter about all this kind of stuff and self-driving cars and everything I can think of. I put out a newsletter, and you're free to sign up, and it's a free newsletter. There are some business cards here if you want one to just keep my contact information. When I buy technology, I use mostly Apple devices, and here's all the reasons, and I consulted for hundreds of hospitals around the country. My job was to help them figure out what technology to use, so that's part of my interest is how you decide, make decisions. These are all the things you can do. Somebody buys it because it's the price, somebody popularity, or a recommendation. I know a guy who wouldn't buy an Apple product because his son hated Apple company. And I thought, I have never heard a more bizarre decision-making reason than that one. But me, down there at the bottom, I want things that work well together. So I have an iPhone, I have an iPad, and I have an iMac. And 90% of what I do on a computer today is done on this iMac that I've got in front of me right now. It has a good keyboard, and the keyboard comes off, so I can just pick up this part or sit it down with the keyboard if I want to use it. That's my primary computer for almost what I do hours and hours every day. I did get one other interesting little bit of technology. You all use USB drives. Well, here's a nice one. But you notice the wireless symbol up there at the top. That's because this one right here is wireless. If I turned it on, anybody in this room could access this drive, load and download files off of it. So it's I just bring it to show it off and things. I'm not gonna turn it on because I do have some files on here that I don't want you to get. I did make a backup of this. Since I use the iPad and the Apple software, I always make a backup, which I never use. So there's a PowerPoint version on this drive as well. Let's talk about money. Anybody interested in money? Why do we need new payment systems? This is topic number one, and it's going to be topic number one for the next 10 years. And a lot of what's going on started as much as 3, 4, 5 years ago. And the reason is that credit cards are a terrible way to pay for things. And why would I take 1980s technology on a credit card and give it to somebody I've never seen before and let them walk into the back room of their restaurant or hardware store and keep it for 5 minutes and then bring it back out? In that time, their cousin in Kokomo could have ordered a new refrigerator using my credit card because they've got the thing and the availability of everything they need to buy a product with that credit card. And we still use them every day, casually. They tell us, sign your name here. They never look at the signature. That's supposed to prove that you own this credit card. Never look at the signature. So I do like everybody else, just draw a line through it. They don't care. If they don't look at it then, they're not gonna look at it later. And so if you just use this example, you look at companies who have lost as much as 80 or 85 million of your credit cards at one time. Nobody really wants my credit card. They want 50 million of them that they can steal from Target while they're sitting on their couch, I guess. So, kind of things that I like to do, and number one, tapping to pay. How many people in here use Apple Pay or Android Pay or Google Pay and tap to pay at a counter? How many? Two. Two, three, four, okay, we have a small number. It's been around now for about 4 years. And when you do it, when you tap your iPhone or your Android phone on a computer, on the terminal, zero chance they'll steal your credit card. And so as quick as I can convert over, and I went to stores all over from Mall of America to Rosedale, and I checked as many of them as I could. And I found out that about half of the stores that I checked actually took Apple Pay. That's the one I tried, the other half didn't yet. Mall of America, Macy's didn't take Apple Pay, but the Rosedale Macy's did take it. They're rolling them out store by store. Pay bills online. I've got a couple of insurance policies gonna be due on State Farm. And so if I opened my iPhone app, State Farm app, it would say, here are the policies that are due in the next couple of weeks. Tap on one to pay it, tap on the button that says Apple Pay, and it will be paid without the insurance company ever seeing my credit card number or that being compromised. The real fun one, though, is when we get into so-called peer-to-peer systems, ways for me to give you money or you to give me money. We'll try it that way first. You may have heard of the name Square Cash. Has anybody used Venmo in here? Do we have any? One, two, okay, well. Where's that college student crowd? Because every time you hear somebody talk about how you use Venmo, the example they give is if you want to split a bar tab, you should use Venmo. Well, I don't know when you went to college, but when I went to college, A, I didn't have enough time, and B, I didn't have enough money to be splitting bar tabs. But apparently that's what college students do today. And the thing that most of them don't know, and most users of Venmo don't know, is it's an app that you put on, and you have the app, and you can then send money back and forth directly from one account to the other. When you do that, the default setting is that Venmo wants to be a social media site. They don't want to be a bank, they want to be a social media site. So the default setting is that every transaction you put in Venmo is open to everybody in the world. So if you have used Venmo in the last couple of weeks and didn't know about this setting, I could put your name in and I would see who you gave money to. I wouldn't see the amount. And you think, well, is that a good idea or a bad idea? What's wrong with that? But it's the fact that they want everybody to know it's a social media site. So we're gonna make it available and you have to turn that off and say, I don't want that to happen. Okay. Now I mentioned the Venmo and there's most of these systems, and there's dozens of them out there, most of these systems are free if you're using your debit card. If you're using a credit card, then you pay credit card charges. But if you send And I said, I owe you some money, and you live on the other side of town, I owe you $30. A, I'm not gonna drive over there, you're a long ways away. B, if I write a check, if you've written a check, take it to a post office or a mailbox, and all the shenanigans that it takes to get that money from me to you, when I could just Venmo it and you'd have it sent directly into your account. Now, who is afraid of this technology? Well, I will tell you, the big banks are. All of a sudden, everybody's figuring out a way to go around the bank. Have you been in a bank lately? If you do, it's like they've had a, you know, an evacuation or something. There is nobody in there. I don't go in there except if I want you to deposit a check that's bigger than $30,000, you actually have to go into the bank. I don't do that very often, so I hardly ever go in that bank. They have a system, the banks came up with one, a competitor, it's called Zelle. And if you get a bank statement from Citibank or any other big bank that there is, any one big bank, it will say, you should start using Zelle. I have a U.S. bank account, and this is what it says. This is my screen from when I log on to U.S. Bank. Send money with Zelle. Now, the reason that that's a step above Venmo and the others is because you have to match up your app to do that. But if you have Citibank and I have Wells Fargo or something else, they are working together. It's phenomenal. At least 40 big banks are in on the Zelle system. And if somebody has one of those bank accounts and you have another one, you can transmit money to them. So that's a really big deal, and you'll start seeing the Zelle. I worry about banks. I did want to transmit some money to somebody early on Saturday morning, and I put in a transmission amount who I wanted it sent to, a family member. And I get this notice on Saturday morning that says, well, that won't be delivered today or tomorrow or Monday because that's a holiday, so they'll get it on Tuesday. So we have this incredible electronic system out there, and what happens? It takes 3 days for a transaction like that to happen. And if I was one particular bank, I think I would want to change my logo or my image. I want to get, this reminds me too much of how banks work today. You know, this is the way banks are. They still have bankers' hours, apparently. They aren't on 24 hours a day. And of course, one thing you probably a lot of you do, I deposited my checks just by taking a picture of them. Now, new types of currency. This is where we get into the fun stuff. Called cryptocurrency is the general name. We talk about Bitcoin, it's a form of cryptocurrency. Here's three big names. Bitcoin is the one you've heard about the most, Ripple is another one, and Ethereum is another one. These are three names you ought to know, but here's 10 more names if you're interested, and there's 30 more names that have an evaluation of over $1 billion already in their companies. So there's huge numbers of these. I'm gonna skip past some of these here pretty quick. Ethereum, go to their website, ethereum.com. You're gonna go to the website for ripple.com, but what do you do that? Anybody heard of Ripple Wine? Just about the same as Thunderbird, those big names. It is, Ripple is a kind of currency, but it's also described in this wine ad. And here's another one that I just got this yesterday. Stellar, the cryptocurrency poised to be the next Bitcoin and Ripple. Experts speaking at the personal finance website Finder predicted recently that Stellar's market cap would rise to $183 billion by the end of the year. To put that in perspective, Bitcoin is only at $233 billion. So that's how fast some of this action happens. Remember the slide I showed you, the slide I showed you earlier that showed how Ethereum and Ether is their coin. How that had gone up to the top and everybody else is falling. Well, let's look at what happened yesterday. Here's up in the left-hand corner are three currencies, Bitcoin, Ethereum, and Ripple. And look at how much they went down by noon or early afternoon yesterday, less than a day. 21%, 25%, and 37% in a few hours. Now, the reason, and here's another one, this is Ripple. How would you like to own it there and figure out when was the right time to sell it? Because this is how it plummeted yesterday. Today, just bottom fell out. One of the theories I heard was the reason this happened is because the Chinese are big investors in these products, and at their end of their year, their Lunar New Year coming up, they want to cash out and spend money on stuff. So a lot of that, I just read this today, they bailed out and caused the market to plummet. So you've got to have nerves of steel and an incredible sense of timing if you want to do this. But let's talk about the really important development. It's not Bitcoin, it's not Ethereum. What I list as world's greatest inventions. Now, I made up this list so that we can challenge this, but I go back to the printing press, which is about the year 1450 or something. The computer, roughly 1940, invented, you all know, at Iowa State University. And if you don't know that, I can give you that story, because that's where I went to college. And the third one is the internet, roughly 1980. And what's the next great invention? Yeah?
AI.
Artificial intelligence, we have a bid back there. That's a good choice, yeah.
Smartphones?
Smartphone, could be, yeah, yeah.
Blockchain.
I hear somebody talk about blockchain. What the heck is that? Year 2008, this is my prediction. Now, it'll take a number of years, so nobody will remember I said this, but I think blockchain is the next one on that list. If you're talking about information technology, the blockchain is the structure that holds Bitcoin together. It's like the World Wide Web sits on top of the internet. Well, Bitcoin sits on top of the blockchain. But the blockchain is much more powerful than just a way to send money around. So that's my reasoning for thinking it's going to be big. It was invented by somebody called Satoshi Nakamoto, some people think. Nobody's ever met him. A lot of people claim to be Satoshi Nakamoto. So nobody really knows who invented it. It just kind of showed up, and this name was assigned to it. A whole lot of people claim they were the guy, but you know, they look more like they were from Missouri than Korea or something. So anyway, this is the technology that I think is going to really, in one form or another, change the world. And of course, we can't forget about the humble zero and one. Those were great inventions. There was a time when people didn't have a zero. If you didn't have something, you didn't have to say it. You just didn't have it. If you had it, you started to count them. But if you didn't have anything, you didn't write down zeros for anything. I don't know who it was. I used to know who invented the zero. Thank God we have it. There was a Dilbert cartoon where they ran out of zeros, and so they had to do all their programming with just ones. That's funny if you're a programmer. But if we're going to expand it beyond just technology and information technology, I would only add one other thing to make this more of a worldly list. And we all know what that would be? Pizza. Now it's the top list if we want to go on. So blockchain is incredibly complicated. I don't understand it, and I have been studying it, and I'm going to study it more. A collection, a network of computers and software that all work together to record transactions. And the blockchain that supports Bitcoin has these computers all over the world. And when I give you a Bitcoin, which was only worth $1,000 now, yesterday it was $2,000, if I gave you a Bitcoin, that all those computers make a note of that. And once they all agree that I have one less Bitcoin and you have one more Bitcoin, then that thing is locked and cannot be changed again. It's a perfect, permanent transaction record. And that's the idea of blockchain. That's this, and it's not controlled by a government. It's not controlled by any central organization. It is this network that works somehow to make all this happen. Now, there's a lot more important things to keep track of than just who has which Bitcoins. And you're familiar with the term supply chain or anything where you want transactions, particularly international transactions, and you want them to happen quickly and reliably and not be hacked or anything else. One of the big potential uses I've heard is potentially to use blockchain technology to support supply chain management. So there is a permanent record that says you are going to deliver a million gadgets to me on a certain date, and it says I am going to pay you a certain amount on a certain date, and that agreement can never be erased or altered by anybody else. A lot of different things like that. If you go to the list of companies who are playing with blockchain, it would be every major company that's out there, you know, IBM and Microsoft, everybody, they're trying to figure out uses for that technology. So that's why it's really important. I want to keep going here, kind of move quickly.
Do you take questions or?
Why don't we wait a few minutes?
Okay.
Yeah, I'll try and get through as much of this. The Internet of Things, and this is part of a three-part series. We're not going to get to the cybersecurity part. What is the definition of the IoT? It's that our internet uses people storing and retrieving information, but with the Internet of Things, millions of things, gadgets will be communicating over the internet with people and with each other. And actually, we could make that billions because that's how fast it's exploding. And the question is, what could go wrong? And the answer is a whole lot of things. Does anybody recognize any commonality, anything about this list that might ring a bell? And the answer is probably nobody does, because I just made it up. Minecraft, anybody know what Minecraft is? Anybody play the game? Okay, I saw a quick hand went up there. I quit playing games after Pong and Space Invaders. Anybody play those games? I gave up. But anyway, Minecraft apparently is a pretty big deal at any one time. There's like a million people online playing Minecraft right now. There, and I'm trying to tie these things together. Over in the far right, one of these stories all end up with three college students involved, or two. And the three college students, do you know what denial of service is? If you have a website and you're going to have a sale, and you're going to have Saturday morning, your website's going to be big, and I'm a competitor of yours, what I could do is if I could get a whole bunch of other people with their computers to go call up your webpage and just keep calling up your webpage and doing it over and over and over again so that legitimate users of your website couldn't access it. That's denial of service, one of the single biggest crimes that's going on right now. But I don't have a lot of friends to talk into doing that, so I hire a company. There's a company who has installed software, probably half the computers in this room, or maybe large numbers of them, and you don't know it's there, nobody knows it's there, but it's got a small bot, and it's just sitting there waiting to be commanded. I hire this company, and I can say, I want 1,000 bots, and I want them for 2 hours in the morning when the guy's opening his website, just starting in his business. I want to rent them for 2 hours, and so that'll be $75 or whatever, and the minute I do that, 9 o'clock in the morning, all of those 1,000 or whatever number I rented will start going after your website and effectively block it from working. Denial of service, that's the big crime that's going on, and it got bigger with what's happening up here. Minecraft was this fun game, I guess, and the Minecraft company made a lot of money, but they decided they wanted to make more money. And one way they could do it was selling to other people the right to build their own little module. And I guess if you're really into this stuff, you pay money for stuff when you're in your real money. It's not play money. And so other companies came in, built their own little Minecraft modules, made their own set of rules, their own whatever, but they're within Minecraft. And now those companies are making money if they can get you to wander around through this environment and stumble into their environment, sell you stuff. They make money. Now, they are competitors. This company wants you to come into their part. This company wants you to come into their part. These guys came up with a bot system to attack those modules in Minecraft so that I can shut yours down and they'll have to come to me. So it was a real legal monetary battle within the game Minecraft. That was their thought. The thing got exploded bigger and bigger, and when somebody was on the trail thinking they might know who's doing this, and this was international people trying to figure this out over the last 2 or 3 years, the saboteurs, the three college students, said, well, one way we will throw people off the trail, we'll publish our software online, let anybody else use it. So all of a sudden, it's not just me doing this heinous crime, it's other people all around that would throw people off the trail. Which means, now that these three guys have been caught, they are, I'm not sure if they've been sentenced yet, but that's going on right now. The genie is out of the bag, and so those kind of things can go on. They shut down many computers all up and down, I think it was the East Coast and in Asia about a year ago, this huge disruption. And so, and even worse, you want to make it worse, the domain name servers, that's the directory of internet sites. And without the domain name servers running all over the world, you couldn't go to my website, Braley.com, because you have to type in Braley.com. That goes off to a domain name server where they give you the address back, and it's a series of numbers, and then your computer can get my website. They attack the domain name servers, and that effectively shuts down the internet if the domain name servers. They went after the biggest company that's out there with the domain name servers. So it's a nightmare waiting to happen, or is happening, but it's a huge, huge problem. Okay, what are the things that are going to be in the Internet of Things? Well, all this stuff. I want to show you a problem with it. If you were to look out in the parking lot, it wasn't such a muddy day, this would be the vehicle that you would see that belongs to me. And it looked really nice. I mean, it's in mint condition, but last year, as a matter of fact, it was old enough to vote. So it actually didn't vote. It was a fraudulent voter. Yeah, like Sienna Van voted last year. But there is a problem with technology when you think about it related to automobiles and appliances, and right here is the problem. We are in two different worlds. Vehicles and appliances last about 15 years, roughly. But what about computer technology? How long does computer technology last? Well, I said roughly 5 years, you know, that might be a lifetime. So, what if I had my beautiful Sienna van, and I had the best computer technology available for that device in the year that I bought it, 1999. And what would that technology look like? It'd be a Windows 98 PC technology that would be in that van. Do you think that would still work today? Do you think it would? What would happen to it? And I think when I see the self-driving cars, I see all the stuff that's being poured into automobiles, and I realize that the car will last way longer than the underlying technology. And people would say, well, they'll upgrade the software. Well, they didn't upgrade that Windows 98 computer enough for me to keep it going, you know. And they're not going to do it. That way, some of this stuff is just going to die a real miserable death. The issues with the Internet of Things, connectivity is the biggest one. How do I put all these pieces together? Oh, wait a minute. I forgot one thing. The guys that came up with this scheme to use bots to shut down the internet, how did they get a lot of their bots? They went out on the internet and they did a search of web cameras. This is everybody's got a webcam up, and that webcam's hooked up to the internet. They searched for them and found the billions of them that are out there that are still using this the basic password, didn't upgrade the password. They grabbed on all of those and started using them in their bot process, because the technology was great, but the user didn't bother to upgrade the passwords, and those webcams are part of this bot network today. Security and privacy, the problem is we have all kinds of apps out there, all kinds of technologies out there, but a tiny number of real security experts, and they are not going to go to work for you or me. They're working for the government, they're working for IBM, they're working for somebody. So protecting your webcam isn't the highest priority in the world. If you go to Best Buy, you get all these kind of things that you can buy. They're all over the place, and you have to try and tie them together now. And there's not just Mac operating system and, you know, all of these things. There's dozens of different kinds of technology that you're going to be dealing with. I'm going to skip ahead here because I want a couple of quick ones and then I'll be done. Okay, I talked about in the previous slide that you didn't see about putting your refrigerator online.
You're actually making good time, so you've got another, say, 10 minutes or so at least.
Okay.
All right, before you go into the question session.
Okay, that's fine. Here was if you didn't put your refrigerator on, and Samsung about 2 years ago made the statement, we are going to put every one of our devices, gadgets that we sell, is going to be on the internet. Well, they sell vacuum cleaners, they sell deep freezers, they sell refrigerators, but that was their comment. And you have to know one thing about Samsung, And we think of them as just this big company that sells TVs, but they, Samsung is a conglomerate by our definition, except one big difference. It's led by the founding family. You inherit the right to be the president of Samsung. The original founder, Mr. Samsung, I'm not sure that was his name, he died. His son took over. Now, his son is, in theory, still in charge of the company, but he's been in a coma for 3 years. And he's, they're just waiting for him to die, because his son has been really running the company. Dad's in the hospital, he can't do anything. The son's been running the company, but he has a problem today, and that is he's in jail for a fraud committed with the president of South Korea, who is also either in jail, she was impeached, and she's out of the business. So you think about a company, and it's a, you go into the company town, you can go to a Samsung hospital, you can get buildings built, and I assume Caterpillars or whatever, made by Samsung. It's that kind of a company, but a whole different culture. I'm gonna talk about one other thing here. Okay, not your refrigerator. What about your thermostat? Who makes thermostats?
Honeywell,
yes we do. Flapper damper, anybody know the flapper damper that was the original Honeywell invention? But Google makes it. Why would Google make a thermostat? I mean, they're a search engine, what the heck? Well, my figuring is that they know everything you do when you're online, but they don't know what you're doing when you're not online. Well, if we stick a thermostat right smack in the middle of your home that can hear you, see you, sense your motion, know when you go in and out of the door, know when you have company, all of a sudden they have a whole different level of information. But here is a problem with Google's thermostat business. They decided to buy another company. Well, as it turns out, this other company they bought happens to sell a thermostat. And the story, the thermostat was called Revolve. And Google recognized pretty quick that they didn't need another thermostat, so they said, we're not going to sell the thermostat. We got the company, but we're not going to sell the thermostat. A few months later, not very much later, many months later, they said, we have decided not to support the thermostats that are out there. And you have, as a user, you have 2 months of use, and then it's going to be shut off. Well, you know, when I was, you know, with simple equipment, if I bought a toaster and the toaster company went out of business, the toaster would still make toast, right? Well, if Google decides to go out of the business with Revolve, they shut down the servers that are required for the Revolve thermostat to work, and the product stopped working within like 45 days. There was one story I remember of a guy who had his whole thing set up. He had his sprinkler system, he had his security system, everything running through this Revolve network. And I'm guessing there's a lot of lawsuits, I was guessing there's a lot of payoffs, but when your system gets that complicated, but requires a company to be in business for a couple of decades, it's pretty touchy stuff. And here's the problem I see. We go into our house and we hook everything up that we can, and we have got the thermostats, the environmental monitor, the vacuum cleaner that we're controlling online on the internet. We got all that stuff, but there's a, so make life easier. But then there's this other side that says we got the Fitbit tracker and we've got the health app and we've got all of these things that are going to keep us healthy. So there's a kind of a yin and yang here, I guess, because we run the risk with all the technology, we don't have to get off the couch while we're trying to be the most fit generation you've ever seen. So, that's where I'm going to quit.